So we know that a rate expression in terms of changing concentration and time is one way to determine the rate of a reaction, and that's actually how it's defined, change in concentration as time goes by. But I also mentioned that it's hard to monitor that. And so up on deck is the rate law. And the rate law is a way of obtaining the rate of a reaction without having to monitor every time how the concentration is changed. So what is the rate law? It is a way of expressing the relationship of the rate of the reaction, which is what we're wanting to know, to some kind of rate constant, okay, a constant, we'll talk about that, and the concentrations of the reactants. You look at the reactants and you say, what is its concentration right now? I don't have to monitor it changing. And you'll take that raised to some power, okay? So that's what a rate law is. Rate is equal to a rate constant times the concentration of reactants raised to some powers. All right, so here is a generic reaction that we looked at when we were doing the rate expression. A plus B goes to C plus D, where we have the coefficients written in. The rate law looks like this. Rate is equal to, okay, so the constant we use, the symbol we use for the constant is a lowercase k, okay, so keep that in mind, that is a rate constant. The reactants were A and B, and they're raised to some powers. Notice it does not say it's raised to the powers of the coefficients. The coefficients may or may not be those powers. We don't know, but that is the rate law. Well, how do we obtain X and Y? They must be determined experimentally. Now let's talk about the word law for just a minute. A rate law. This means that once you've established this law and you've determined those powers, every time you do the experiment, it will always give you the rate of that reaction. A law is something that is repeated over and over again. You're getting the same observation every time, and we've put a mathematical expression to that. Remember Boyle's law and Charles's law with gases? Let's just pick one of them. Let's pick Charles's law. You heat something up, it expands. You cool it down, it contracts. We learned that that's a law of gases. They do it consistently, and we could put a mathematical expression to it. So once you determine those powers for a specific reaction, it will obey that law every time you do the reaction. So it is initially takes some work to come up with the law for that reaction. But once you have the law, you no longer have to monitor how it's changing with time. This will give you how it will change with time. So we're going to eventually, not in this lesson, learn how to determine those powers. We won't go and do an experiment, but we'll be given experimental data in order to determine those powers. But let's just look at some information to begin with, all right? So here we have a graph, and in this graph, we're seeing along the left-hand side the rate of the reaction, okay, in molarity per second. This is how fast it's going, and we see that it's going at different speeds depending upon what concentration of A we have. We don't have to see A started here and finished there. We can just at any moment in time, we see how fast the reaction is going. Now, when we monitor that, we can see that this is a nice straight line. This is a linear relationship. We love linear relationships, okay? When you have a linear relationship, we know that rate is directly, and that's what that little symbol means, directly proportional to its concentration. And if it's directly proportional to its concentration, we can replace that proportionality symbol with an equal sign. So now we have a rate law that was experimentally determined. They had to do initial monitoring of how fast the reaction is, and they determined that these were the speeds that took place. They found out that it was a nice linear relationship and determined that it was a power of one for the A's concentration. Now that was just A, monitoring A. You'd have to go and monitor B and see what its power is. So K is called your rate constant, I told you that. It does have units. Its units are going to be different depending upon what the rate law is, because I want to put some information up here on the screen, and I have a pen in my back pocket. All right, here we go. We know that rate has to be in units of molarity per some time, and I'll use seconds as my time. And K times the A to some power, and in this case, the first power, we know that concentration is molarity. So there's a molarity. So what would K have to be in this case? It would have to be 1 over seconds, because 1 over seconds times molarity would give you molarity times seconds. But if this rate law had different powers, it had more than one substance, the units for K would change over and over again depending upon what the rate law is, okay? So you got to know it has units. It will have units. Its units will be different depending on what this rate this rate law looks like, because always on the left-hand side we need molarity per time, or molarity per second in this case, okay? So, if I know the rate value, and I know a value for A for one of the experiments, I could come up with the value, not just the units, but the value for the rate constant. You can actually know numerically what that rate constant is. So, we take it one step further. Every time the reaction takes place at a given temperature, it will always have that value of K. So the rate law is true every time the reaction takes place. The value for K is that value every time it takes place at a certain temperature, because temperature will affect the rate of a reaction, and we'll see how as we proceed through these lessons. Okay, so let's look at a reaction, a specific reaction. So we have this reaction taking place, and somebody went and did all the work to come up with the rate law. So experiments have to be done, measurements have to be taken, and they are able to, from that, come up with the rate law. Now here is what it was determined experimentally. Those powers happen to be the same as the, no they don't. They happen to be the same as the coefficient for NO, doesn't it? But it's not the same for H2, and the coefficients are not why you have those powers. It was experimentally determined. Now for this, I'm just giving you some language that you got to get familiar with when you're talking about kinetics. I don't know why they use this language, but they do, and so we have to get used to it. We use the word order, okay, that tells us the power. So what we would say is, if we look at the power of NO, we say this reaction is second order in NO. That tells me it's to raise to the second power. For the H2, we would say it's first order in hydrogen, first order in the H2. We could also talk about the overall order, and all you have to do is add those powers together, so we would say that this is third order overall, okay? This lets the hearer of somebody who's familiar with kinetics to know how the concentration is going to affect the rate of the reaction. When it's raised to a second power, it affects the rate more drastically than if it were raised to a first power, right? If you're squaring something or cubing something, it's going to affect the rate more drastically. So a person kind of gets used to the language, thinking about the order, and it tells them something about how that guy's concentration will affect the rate. Now you can have zero order. What would that mean? If something's raised to the zero power, anything raised to the zero power is one. That means its concentration does not affect the rate, and that can happen. You can also have fractions. I've seen fractions for powers. I've also seen negative numbers for powers, and that is very, very bizarre, okay? So that doesn't happen very often, but I have seen that in some instances. So, usually, they're nice whole numbers, but they don't have to be. Okay, so now we've got a rate law. This is the rate law we were talking about there. And I want you to look at that rate law. I said that when you know the order, it tells you something about how changing the concentration will affect the rate. Okay, so let's think about this one. What happens if you did an experiment twice and you the H2 ends up being doubled on your experiment, and you don't change the NO. So you run the experiment twice, you have a certain amount of NO and a certain amount of H2, and then you run the experiment a second time where you're doubling the amount of hydrogen. What's that going to do to the rate of the reaction? You want to stop and you want to think about that rate law and see if you can come up with the answer. And then I want to see if you can develop a good answer for this one. All right, did you say that it would double it? Okay, then it would. Then you got it right. Now let me write this rate law up here. Let me give you a kind of a way of thinking about this. Okay, so we have NO squared times the H2. Now, one way you can do this is just plug some numbers in that are convenient, okay? Well, we don't know the value for that, but let's say the first time we run this experiment, we use ones, okay? So that's going to give me 1k, right? 1 squared times 1. And then the second time, I'm going to call that number 1. The second time I do it, what does it say we're going to do? We're going to double the concentration of hydrogen, but not change the concentration of this. So I keep that the same, but I double that. So I went from 1 and still 1, 1 to 2, and that's going to give me 2K. So what happened? As I doubled the hydrogen, it doubled the rate of the reaction. And that's what something does when it's first order. Changing, doubling its concentration will double the rate. Tripling its concentration will triple the rate. Cutting the concentration in half will cut the rate in half. That is what a first order will do. Now, you might want to use this technique for the second question here. Now, in this question, we're going to do what? We are going to double the NO, okay, and keep this constant. Okay? So what does that do? That is going to quadruple the rate. So let's think about our next scenario, comparing this to the situation where, and I'll call it the third case, we are doubling the NO without changing the hydrogen. So when I compare these two, I get 4 times its constant. So it's quadrupling it. Now, I've seen test questions where they say, what happens if you double this but make this one half as big? Okay, well, you can put ones and then you can put a 2.5 and you can see, you know, well, that doubles it, whatever. So make sure you can use this little technique to walk your way through once you know a rate law and determine how does the concentration affect the rate. And that's what a rate law will do. It'll help you determine a rate if you know the concentrations. And it will help you understand how the rate will change as you modify those concentrations. Okay, so we now know what a rate law is. We know how a rate law will affect the rate of the reaction. What we need to do next is learn how to take experimental data and come up with a rate law. Before we do that, let's just think about it. It's kind of the opposite of what we did here. Here we knew the rate law. And from the rate law, we could see how changing a concentration affects rate. What we're going to do next is see how concentration affects rate, and from that, be able to get a rate law.